Hello and welcome to The Written Word, a product of Harvard Medicine Magazine. I'm Stephanie Duchin from the Office of Communications at Harvard Medical School. We are here today with two physician researchers, Anupam Jena, who goes by Bapu, and Christopher Worsham, to talk about their book, Random Acts of Medicine, The Hidden Forces That Sway Doctors, Impact Patients, and Shape Our Health. Bapu is the Joseph P. Newhouse Professor of Healthcare Policy, and Christopher is a teaching associate in the Department of Healthcare Policy in the Blavatnik Institute at HMS. They both also practice medicine at Massachusetts General Hospital. Random Acts of Medicine explores the underappreciated role that chance plays in health and healthcare. As much as we might want to believe that we have control as patients or as medical practitioners, the authors show how pervasive and significant the effects can be of random occurrences. Yet, the authors also explain how chance events provide invaluable opportunities to understand and improve human health. Chris, Bapu, thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having us.
Thank you for having us.
How did the idea for the book come about? Why did you two write it?
You know, one of the questions that we struggle with a lot in medicine, probably one of the most important questions is, if someone has a disease, how do you treat it? And the typical way we answer that question is we develop treatments and then we study whether or not those treatments are better than the treatments that exist already. And we like to do that through large randomized trials where you take a group of people who have a disease and you randomize some of them to get the treatment and others not to. And that allows you to say something about the causal effect. What is the effect of that treatment on that disease? Now, those trials can be hard to do for a lot of different reasons. One, they're expensive. They require lots of people to be recruited. Sometimes it takes many years to study. And what Chris and I and people like us have spent a lot of time doing is thinking, are there situations in the world that provide natural experiments that allow us to answer that question about what works and what doesn't work in a different way? These sorts of questions, like what happens to people who are hospitalized when cardiologists are all out of town at their national meetings? These sorts of freakonomics meets medicine type of questions have been of interest to me for a long time. And I don't know, 5 or 6 years ago, when Chris was training as a critical care doctor at MGH, he sent me an email. And that was the start of a really beautiful relationship. In the book, I talk about Chris as a first sort of as a colleague and now a friend. And we've had a lot of fun working together on research. And then a few years ago, we thought, you know what? Maybe we should write a book about all of this work, and a lot of which we've done together.
And a big piece of that is we are healthcare policy researchers. And so the questions we're asking are ones that we think are going to be of interest to people who are shaping and designing the healthcare system. And if we can't explain that research and show people what it means in a way that's approachable, digestible, and we try to be a little bit entertaining, then we can't learn from it as a society. So one of the big things we wanted to do with this book was just bring this research to anybody who is interested in healthcare, what we can learn from data, and maybe isn't afraid of a graph or two.
And Chris, we don't try to be entertaining. We are entertaining.
Oh, yeah,
right?
True.
Yeah.
Well, that leads in nicely to the question of who is this book for and what do you want people to get from it?
Yeah, so we purposefully wrote it for anyone with the idea that at the beginning, we kind of ease people into the concept of natural experiments, which are what happens when patients or people are sort of randomly by chance sent down one path or another. So one example, and this comes from a study that Bapu and I worked on, after he came in one day, because he had brought his son to the pediatrician for his checkup. His son's born in August, got his checkup. The doctor said, come back in a couple weeks to get your flu shot. My son's also born in the summer. Same thing happened to us. We went in for a checkup, but the flu shot wasn't available because it was summertime, so we had to come back. And that got us thinking, well, kids were happened to be born in a different month, so just by chance, randomly, are born in the fall and not in the summer. When they go for their checkup, they can get their flu shot right there. It's a lot easier for them to get their flu shot. So this is a natural experiment. Kids, by chance, are set up to either get their flu shot easily while they're at their checkup, or they're set up to a more challenging pathway where their parents have to bring them back for another one. And what that allows us to do is study the impact of that challenge. And what we found in the study was that there's about a 15 percentage point difference in the chance that a kid born in the summer will get their flu shot compared to a kid born in the fall. They're much less likely. And that also allowed us to look at, well, what's the impact of these flu shots? Those kids born in the summer who were less likely to get a flu shot were more likely to get the flu, and they were also more likely to spread it to older family members in their home.
Fascinating. So that would be an example of a natural experiment that can reveal something about the healthcare system. And I know that your book is packed with examples like that. Can you tell us a bit about how natural experiments can reveal things, not just about patterns in health, but also things that might be able to be improved in the healthcare system?
Yeah, let me give you an example. I joked earlier about what happens to patients who are hospitalized when cardiologists go out of town. Well, we've looked at that. And basically what we show is that during the dates of large cardiology conferences, like the American Heart Association annual meeting, patients who are hospitalized with an acute cardiac condition, their mortality actually falls during the dates of those meetings. The other data point that we see is that the rates of certain cardiac procedures also fall. They fall by about 30%. Now, what does that teach us about medicine and healthcare? Well, there is this phenomenon that people talk about, which is, quote unquote, less is more. It's the idea that sometimes in medicine, as much as we're attracted to the idea of doing more testing, more treatments, and lots of time it's good and important, but there are instances where it might be the case that sometimes less aggressive medical care might be better for somebody. And here, I think, is a clear illustration of how that might play out. And it also gives us a framework for thinking about that question more broadly. If we wanted to do that sort of experiment across lots of different specialties and lots of different treatments, we would be able to do that. And we'd be able to unpack in a real world setting, what is the effect of this treatment? Is it the case that more of that treatment is better? Or might it be the case that for certain people, it's better to actually pull back a little bit?
Relatedly, I was wondering what is the most striking or the most important thing that you learned while you were working on this book?
Yeah, I think when we assemble all of these studies together, and I think we have 300 some odd references at the end of the book that are all looking at the ways in which chance is affecting medical care, I think intuitively we start to think like, well, why are doctors subject to chance? Why are we letting chance impact patients? And I think that's a really good question. And at the core of it is that we're humans, just like the patients that we're treating. As much as some of us might kind of think we're superhuman or patients might look at us that way, we're people too. And we're subject to the same biases, the same mental shortcuts as everyone else. And I think it's easy to sort of shrug your shoulders about that and say, like, well, I guess we're just going to make mistakes and things will be bad because of it. But it's that same humanity that leads to those things happening to patients because of chance that actually also makes us really good at our jobs, makes us able to respond to the individual needs of patients, be able to look at research and evidence that's based on a group of people and try to apply it to one person. There's so much about being a doctor that is beyond the data. And I think as much as this is an exploration of the data, it actually really highlights what doctors are really doing. And we have a chapter about what makes a good doctor. And one of the morals of the story there is that it's about those human connections and our ability to connect with patients and build trust with patients that probably contribute most to what makes one doctor better than the other.
That sounds really satisfying to work on.
It was, yeah.
we had a good time, and it's easier to write a book as a team than as one person.
Well, I hope that the book achieves what you're hoping that it achieves and that everyone learns more about what is underlying our health and our healthcare for the improvement for everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being with us today. We've been talking with Bapu Jena and Christopher Worsham about their book, Random Acts of Medicine. It's been really interesting.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Learn more on our website at magazine.hms.harvard.edu.